This is Magic Mall, the party spark of the J Team, A-Time Extraordinaire, the Caterator.
This is your boy Chuck C from them Throwback Boys, Stacks on Deck, Zone 3 representative.
And this is Atlanta Rap History.
First rap we had was Let Mojo Hallett, and then MC Shotty came with the Pink Panther. Who rock, that's when D-Rock fell through. And Sammy Sound the Hitman was all brand new. Can't forget my homegirl named Easy T. The hard buzzing ghetto mafia from the east. Success in effect, a group called Damage. King Edward J making mixtapes. Man, it's a whole lot of history folks don't even know about. Leave it up to Raheem, cause I'm about to show out.
Yo, we back again with another episode of Atlanta Rap History. It's your boy Chuck C from them Throwback Boys, Zone 3 representative.
Oh yeah, and it's your boy Magic Moore, the party spark, representing the J Team all day, every day, man.
Yeah, every day, man. And we back again, man, with another episode, man. Listen, man, this episode right here, let me say about this episode, man. This is a correction episode right here, see? Okay. If you go way back to the Shadi interview, I said, when I'm wrong, I admit when I'm wrong. I said that in the Mike Fresh interview. I say, when I'm wrong, I'm big enough to admit when I'm wrong. So if you pay attention to the intro of Atlanta Rap History, it's a part on there where it say, who rock, that's when D-Rock came through. And Sammy Sam the Hitman was all brand new. And if you look at the old episodes, it had a picture of D-Rock, but it was the wrong D-Rock.
Hey, nah.
It was the wrong D-Rock. It was D-Rock number 2.
Okay.
But tonight, we got D-Rock number 1 on the show.
Huh?
We got the original D-Rock. We talking about
original D-Rock.
Who rock? We talking about D-Rock. D-Rock. Montel Holmes Finest. East Point General. Tonight, man. Like I said, the original D-Rock.
Welcome to the show. I like that, nigga. Martel
Home
Finest, nigga.
Martel Home Finest.
That's it, man. Found in the flesh, man.
Yeah, hey, man. Hey, it's a pleasure to have you on the show, man. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. Like I said, man, I'm always big enough to admit when I was wrong. When I made the intro, I put up, when it said D-Rock, I put up D-Rock thinking I knew it was the D-Rock, but I was wrong. That's not the D-Rock that Raheem the Dream is talking about on that song. He's talking about a whole nother D-Rock, the original D-Rock.
Who rocks this motherfucker?
Tonight, baby.
We got it right tonight.
We got the speculate. No damn, we can get the record straight. We get the record straight.
Exactly. So let's get the record straight. Let's get it from the beginning.
Let me say this right here. Two things I want to say. One, in relation to your era, I want to speak on that second. But the first point I want to make is this right here. Just like Shawty Lowe said, feel good to be here, man. You feel good to be here.
Yes, sir.
Feel good to be here, you know?
Yes,
so,
sir.
I always see my history. Now, to the era, you're not the only one that made the era. I charged my brother Sam I seen your interview. I seen Atlanta Rap History interview with Sammy Sam.
Okay.
I seen that with y'all boys.
Okay.
And you know, we was in the trenches together. Sam gave the order, the pecking order of the way the Atlanta rap game started.
Okay.
He first said it was Mojo was correct. He said Raheem was correct. But he said himself, Sammy Sam, was his incorrect.
Oh.
Whoa. You heard it right here on the Letter Rap History, man.
I
love it.
I have to say, man, so, I love that boy there. Matter of fact, I was just down with him on Wright Street, no cap, but years back. But it was Mojo, Raheem, D-Rock, then Sammy Sam. So that's the four right there.
Okay. Y'all heard?
So,
yeah.
So that puts him back to number four then.
My memory is good, but we're getting that. I'm let y'all boys do
things. Okay, yeah. So, hey, this is the History Channel, man. So let's do it from the beginning. Where was you born and raised?
Oh, yeah, I was born in Grady Memorial Hospital in 1969, man. You know me and, you know, a lot of rappers, a lot of artists, they be scared of their age. They scared to show their age, but you know, music for me is like life. I cannot hide my growth. That's like hide my, but that ain't real to me. You know what I'm saying? You make music, right. You make music.
That's right.
Question. For hospital, man, 1969, I'm a greater baby. So I'm a greater baby, no doubt.
Greater baby.
Yes, sir. That made two of us.
Yeah. So, and then, so where did you come up at?
Well, I was, my original address on my birth certificate is 1072 Calhoun Avenue, Martel home, East Point. And that was back in the, but it's kind of funny because it has 1072, but as a kid, I don't remember none of those years because I can think back when I was 5 years old, I was living on Boulder Park Drive in Atlanta, Georgia. We was in living with my family. They was kind of wealthy, well-to-do. You know, mama got sick, so I was sit with my family. You know, I was sit with my other side of my family and big mini mansions. I'm talking about boy, big mini mansion, big house, yard. You know, living. You know. But now that's where I got my foundation for music and reading. You know, those are my two strong suits. Even when I remember when I was 5 years old, because I stayed around books and I stayed around music. Mm. So yeah, I was raised. So I would say Boulder Park Drive got the foundation for music. Came back to Martel home 9 years old. So just being I was living at 1089 Maria Head Terrace.
Okay.
So I moved back with my mom, and that's when I got introduced to the hood life, man. You know,
and like that first street you named, right, Calhoun Street. For everybody out there that don't know, that's where you get a lot of rappers. They talk about Calhoun Street. They talk about Martel Holmes. You got Cutter Calhoun. All they get their names from this street that he talking about.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fred Bell. Shout out to Fred Bell, man. Kim folks, shout out to Fred Bell, man. I love you, man. You know, you put it down. You represented for Martel Holmes, man. I'm proud of you, man. You know, I like what you did, man. You know, I love you, man. You know, and we about to take this thing to the next level. So but yeah, you're right. That's where the Calhoun, what that Slim Calhoun. You know,
Cutty Calhoun.
But believe it or not, even though I was outside, in, you know, I want to jump ahead. But I want to, you know, since we're talking about it, I want to let you know my thoughts of why they was implementing their game plan blueprint, you know, having they run in the game. I was like loving that shit. Even though I was on the outside, wishing I was there, I wish I could give some advice, some consultation or some shit, you know what I'm saying? You know, I'm loving it. I love it, man. I love that it's like, see me, I look at rap like science. I like to study science. It's just like all the great scientists. It's just like, just like people like, Newton, Isaac Newton, you know, the gravity, you know, you discovered the laws of gravity. Then you had, of course you had guys before him and after him. Then you had Einstein in there too. But my point is, each one of them built on what the other laid.
Sometimes
the theory wasn't always correct, but it was the guy trying to figure things out, and other guys add to it. So that's the way I see the Atlanta rap game. It's like, because Mojo, of course, like I say, I used to sit in my room when I was in 1089 Maria Head Terrace. And it was when I was in Maria Head Terrace. Man, oh man, I used to listen to Mojo live at the San Sue. Oh man, what are you talking about, man? I couldn't wait for the days I got. You know,
yeah. Mojo, shout out to Mojo.
Shout out to Mojo.
Legend,
yes,
man.
Sir.
Yeah. He's the first rapper, man. Mojo, yeah. I like this little show. What's the show he got at? Mojo, what's the show you got?
Oh, make sure y'all check him out on Facebook, man. Let Mojo handle it. That's Tuesday at 8:30, man. Live on Facebook, man. Y'all make sure y'all check out Mojo.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, look. I love it for Mojo, man. You know, because he inspired me, though. It was like, as a kid, you know, as a youngster, you know, like, you're into the music, you want to go, but to hear somebody doing it. Whether you think you can do it better or not as good, it doesn't matter. But the fact that someone is doing like what you want to do,
mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. So he was your inspiration, being from Atlanta, outside of the rappers that were from New York. So that gave you even more inspiration that he was from where you from.
Yeah. Mojo. Yeah. Mojo is definitely my inspiration. From Atlanta, boy, hey, 1089, Red Terrace. See, it was like I used to sit back. But see, that's when you had WAOK. Well, put it like this. We all know that it was a time when rap wasn't being broadcast on FM.
Right.
So it was like WIGO, but on Friday night, boy, look at him. Mojo, Keith Pollitt, what is it? Live at the San Sewer. Keep Paul alive in the San Sewer. Keep Paul checking in from 9 to 10 live in the San Sewer.
Right. And you know what? That's what birthed the Fresh Party. That birthed the Fresh Party, being live at the San Sewer on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
The Fresh Party, but look at us. See, that's the thing. That birthed this Fresh Party when I used to be in my room dreaming about being a rap game, but it became a time. When I did the show at Mars Brown Coliseum, it was in 88 in March. It was in 88 of March, somewhere around about this time, somewhere in May. It was me on the bill, Raheem, Heavy D was the headliner.
Okay.
So, Raheem, along with the group 4x4. I don't know if y'all remember them. They was on tour with Janet Jackson at the time. So, they made that. They was like, come over, baby.
Come over, baby.
Yeah. That shit fired him. It was out of time.
I remember that.
But But I just remember that night. Like I say, dream about being on the airways, but that night I was like listening to the Fresh Party in my dressing room upstairs, and while at the same time I'm listening to the I don't know what is that. So I guess my dressing room might have been used in one of the school rooms or something. So I'm looking out beneath for the traffic in the street. So I don't know if that might have been an MLK or the other side. But anyway, I just know, you know, I wasn't the radio synchronized to where someone here is playing the same thing that someone here is playing.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, I heard it. They were, now I'm about to go on in about 5 minutes. I'm pumped. I'm hyped. So you got the guy that announced, he like, we got Atlanta alone, D-Rock, live tonight. You know what I'm saying? Live tonight. And I'm hearing on both radios. Oh, man, look, I'm like, well, let me go ahead and take this shit. Let me go ahead and take it. I took it.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. I'm a bad man on that stage now. I'm going to be honest with you now.
Yeah. I tell you what, man. Hey, your record, man, I remember it being played on the radio, man, just as well as Mojo and stuff back in the day. And they had, actually, it was like a radio version of it. That was one of the first records that I knew of that had a radio version to it.
We made a clean version because I was getting a lot of pressure on the cussing. Because you got to think about, this was when it was the rap game was still building now. Like I said, had no one in Atlanta got rich off rap. So it wasn't another one I could point to and say, you know what? I want to be like him. You know what I'm saying? So you had to create your own template. That's why I say definitely shout out to Raheem. Oh, man. Raheem.
Shout out to Raheem, man. Shout out to Raheem.
Yes, sir.
We did shows together. Oh, yeah, we did shows together. And kind of funny, he was my opening act. So see, I was out with Charles Jr. Rackett. Stay out of my home, you know, the dope boys had the money behind me. So when we went in there shows in Country Town, D-Rock was the headliner. I don't give a damn who had more Rackett sold. But I like that strategy. But I could carry my own, though. You know what I'm saying? I carry my own. But anyway, Raheem.
Yeah.
See, Raheem, now don't put out there. You see how people say Gucci Mane? No doubt. Shout out to Gucci Mane. I love that boy. I've been watching this shit now, trust me. But the way Gucci Mane, like, entrepreneurial side of him is like engineered a lot of careers and helped a lot of people, you know, spring to the next level. Raheem was this. I don't know. I got to say he was the first. You know, I love JD, but, you know, we'll put out there, no comparison. We're going to do that. Both of them great. But we're going to say that for us, like, on the street level, like the raw street level, giving a nigga out the hood, like opportunity. Oh, yeah, Raheem. Yeah, you one of them guys, man. I was admiring for that.
I admire you, man, for your lyrics, man. You know, like I say, experience lyrics and all that stuff, man. You had to have balls back then to be put out a record like that, man. And this was 1987?
1987.
Hey, that was before NWA.
But check this out. But see, you got to think about it. See, Martel Holmes, I came back to Martel at 9 years old. My mom lived on Maria Head Terrace. 10, 8, and 9, my real head terrorist. East Point, Martel Holmes. Okay, so now, it was a lot of cats, like Reginald Starr, he went to MD Collins, like Roger Brooks, Beard, you know what we call them, Po' Boy Fresh, you know, these were guys, believe it or not, even Cigarette, you know, it was a lot of guys, Dwayne and Kelly, you know, that was like, when the hip-hop was like, doing this thing in New York, I already had, you know, getting money in the ball, getting rich, be watching that thing, you know, then watch Crush Groove, went down to Rialto, and I even went to the Rialto and watched Crush Groove. You know, yeah. We was on
it. Okay. Okay.
You know, all my homies, you know, Dream Team, Breakers Incorporated, they was like, put cardboard in the middle of the street, John Freeman Way, cardboard spinning and stuff. For me, I always was a rapper, though.
Well, let me ask you this right here, D-Rock. How did you end up linking up with Swift C, man?
Yes, sir.
That's a bad DJ, man.
And who is Swift C? Tell us who Swift C is and how you hooked up with him.
But I will say Swift C, he changed his name, you know, after he went on the Lucky Calhoun.
Lucky Calhoun.
So, oh.
Yeah, so that's the original Swift C. But you know what? Lucky Calhoun, original Swift, he did work with Outkast them, so they know each other. So I'm assuming that, excuse me, for whatever reason, it was like, I'm gonna take this name and I'm gonna get the other name, you know what I'm saying? Since there was no kind of controversy, I'm assuming that,
But let's go back to the question, like you said, when y'all how you hooked up with him.
Well, at the time I had got with Charles Jr. Charles Jr. was a lieutenant in the drug game. You know, he was like working for a guy named Houdini. We called him Houdini. Joe, that was his name. Rufus is his name. We called him Houdini in the hood. You know, he living like, he worked 20, 25 blocks, you know, at the time in the hood in Martel. So there's another thing about Martel Home people don't realize. Before I came out with the music, Martel Home was a million dollar drug trap.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about, it was like the real Carter. I'm talking about like, four, five guys on the corner with walkie-talkies, getting paid $500 a week to watch out for people. Now this is how it was in Martel Home at the time. You had people like Dre High. I don't know if y'all ever heard of a Dre High, but Dre High, that's my cousin. Shout out to Dre High, man. He one of the first original Martel young niggas to do it. You know what I'm saying? I got to shout out to him, mother. He inspired me. You be a Cool Breeze mentioned him, give him a salute in some of his music. But yeah. So as I was saying, at the time Martel, so it was like a drug business going on. I mean, it's like 10, 20, 30, that's about $30,000, $40,000 a day being made on John Freeman Way.
Mm.
Martel Home. Now.
Big trap.
Yeah, we trapped it. Now Cool Breeze, grandmother lived out there. And you know, Cool, like you know my kid folks, he's a couple years younger than me. But at that time, you had Charles Jones was a lieutenant of this, you know, lieutenant of this going on. And so I stepped to him about starting the record label, you know, because I was in rap, doing mixtapes, and DJ Funzo, you know, I want to get on him too. And so I got with Charles Jr., you know, told him to put some money behind me, convinced him, he put some money behind me. So we went in the studio, I got DJ Funzo, which at the time, you know, he was an East Point DJ. Then in East Point, Martel Home, that whole East Point area. Now, hold on, let me say this right now. Right now, people say East Point. But I'm going to be honest with you now. You know, there's always one place that defines the city.
Right.
You know, like certain, that can be debatable. You know, it's debatable in certain states. Debatable in certain cities. But in East Point, Martel Home defines what East Point is supposed to be like. What I mean by that, back then, we had, like I say, the drug dealers, the blocks, you know, like $30,000, $40,000 trap, $1 million traps, and I'm saying, like, you know, the cars, the jewelry, you know, and the break dancers, you know, we was in the street doing the break dancing. Now, don't get me wrong, College Park was doing their thing. But I'm talking about in the city of East Point. Martel was the center of the culture of life in East Point. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, and even on the rap, you know, and even DJing, you know, that's what how the DJ at East Point was at. DJ Funzo, you know, at that time. So, you know, in Tri-City, Russell High.
That's right.
You know.
Russell High.
Yeah, let me say this now. They was debating about who was the first celebrity or the first entertainer to make it coming out Tri-City. You know, they say Kandy, Burrus. Who else we say? We say Outkast. We say them two boys. What the Cleaning boys? What the boys that came out Tri-City? Yeah, the big boys. But check this out. D-Rock, man.
D-Rock with the first man. One out of Tri-City.
D-Rock!
The first, y'all got the history damn. Right here, man. The first one out of Tri-City was D-Rock, man.
Limousine. Now, hold on,
now, D-Rock, let me ask you this. But Tri-City, though, wasn't Tri-City like a couple, like three schools or something like that put together to make Tri-City?
No. At first, it was Russell High. It was Russell High. And you had Cotty Park High. You had Cotty Park High. And you had a lot of other places, too. Like, you had Woodland High, a lot of other things like that. So, matter of fact, I still remember being in class that year when the teacher told me next year it's going to be Tri-City. They sat down classes. I think this was like 88, 89, one of them, when it became Tri-City.
Yeah. That's how about right.
I remember the teacher telling me that. And so they shut down the neighboring schools and then, you know, combined the Tri-City. And I guess Tri, you know, and you know what I'm saying? And that's how it became Tri-City, you know.
And for everybody out of town, for all my out of town people, Tri-City, that's East Point, College Park. It's East Point, College Park, and Hapeville, right?
Hapeville, because it was Hapeville High. Because, see, I got put out of Tri-City one time. I had put the Hapeville High out there. Had to go to the white folk down there.
Yes, sir. Hapeville. That's Tri-City. They put them all together to make Tri-City.
Yeah.
Well, I got to shout out to one of my artists, man. He out there at Martel Homes, man. Benny Boy Star, man. I got to shout him out, man. You know, so, you know, I fuck with Martel Homes a long way. You know about the star.
Hey, look, make sure you tag him in this right here, though. Benny Boy, that's my people, man.
Oh, already. Already. That's my guy.
That's my he really family. But like, he's some kin to my son. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? My baby mama is just like his... Actually, my baby mama is like his auntie.
Wow.
Yes, sir. So then...
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
hey, so Benny got him and his girl. Hey, look, Benny girl, she's an artist also, right?
Hey, win a star, man. She's something cold. She's my artist too, man. Hey, she's something serious. Them two together, man. Hey, they got some good music, man. So we working on their stuff now, man.
Yeah,
but that's what I like. See, that's what I like, you know what I'm saying, the networking. I like the fact that, like, I got into music not even thinking about the legacy of it. I just was going hard, like, because I want to show people in Martel Homes, East Point, really I want to show in Martel Homes that you can make it right here.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? If you,
that's right.
But you got to be fine. You got to be that dude now, or that girl. You got to be that dude now. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
So always.
A lot of talent came up out of that Martel Homes. A whole lot. Like you said, Slim Calhoun, that whole Calhoun family, the whole Cutter Calhoun. All those guys come from John Freeman Way. When y'all hear the song Way say, come talking about John Freeman Way. He talked about Martel Homes, all these songs and different songs and stuff they be talking about. They talking about this area where he from. We talking about Martel Homes, and we talking about the one that original, the first one from Martel Homes, the first one to put it on the map.
That's right.
We got D-Rock with
us. Well, I have to say this right here. He said his first claim to fame. He said Martel Homes was his claim to fame where he learned the slickest tricks in the dope game.
Where he learned it at Martel Homes, man.
East Point area, we had all the culture. But I want to say this right here. Now, the album cover you seen right there, with the three guys, that is me in the front. And Swift C. And Swift C, you know, Lucky Out Home Swift C. And the light skin guy is Stego. You know, he's my homie. You know, he my homie.
You know,
so he my homie,
you know,
my right-hand man, so I always kept him with
him,
you know what I'm saying? We was hanging before the fame.
That's what's up, man. But I tell you this right here. Hey, I was on the J team, man, over there with Edward J and everything, man. And I think I joined the squad maybe in the late, you know, man, 88, 89, somewhere around, and now I was still in high school. But I do know this right here, that D-Rock record, man, I remember your record with J Tape before I had even got in the game with Elk with J myself, man. And I remember that record, man, he used to put on mixtapes. So, you know, that's when I was a, you know, fan of you just being an artist from Atlanta, you know, at the time, man. You know, because that's something what I always wanted to do. I want to put my name on a backboard somewhere. Yeah, you know what I mean? But, you know, so you part of my inspiration, man, too, just being a rapper. One of the first that had the guts and the balls to come out of Atlanta to even be a rapper.
Yeah.
So, you know, I salute you for that, though, my brother.
Yeah, tell me a little bit about this picture right here.
Oh, yeah. That picture there when I was, that was in the basement of the Rufus. Like I say, the guy, the lieutenant, his boss man, Rufus. And of course, when I drop him making money, he want to step in and take over, no doubt. You know what I'm saying? I can feel that. You know what I'm saying? But that was at his basement, kind of like a little party. Cause I can go down there and practice a lot. So that was the girl that I'm with, that was Charles Jr.'s girlfriend at the time. Okay. So I just took a picture with him. I was like 17 years old at that time.
And, okay.
You know, I remember I was like eating. I'm eating chicken. They like, D-Rod, let's take this picture. Put your food down. I'm like, man, damn that. Take this picture. You want to take this picture? You can take it right now. Down there.
What about this one right here?
Oh, yeah, that's in Martel Homes, man. That's the money making Martel. And that's me standing on top of the 9-8. You know, I had to go out and buy a 9-8. The Public Enemy dropped that 9-8 song, so I went out and buy it. That's me in the silk, man, custom made diamonds. And that's that boy Boo Boo, Robert Tarver, rest in peace, man. One of Martel Homes' greatest. And that Stego right there. With the glasses on, you know, on the bottom. And that's Stego right there, man. That's my homie right there, Stego Love. You know, he's instrumental in my career. Yeah, that's money making my tail home, John Freeman Way.
John Freeman Way. That's what it is, man. That's John Freeman Way, man. All Don John Freeman Way, man.
So,
that's what's up.
So that was me, man. You know, Cool Breeze was rapping. It was me, man, you know. Which I can respect that. When I first got in the rap game, before I had the really done things, I was inspired by the guys before me. And so I just knew when I got my opportunity, I was gonna go hard. So I definitely understand that I inspired Cool Breeze, but yeah, you know, the Martel Homes, hell, I was a young nigga that was the number one out there, didn't it? You know, I'm talking about, okay, yeah. So at the time, you know, like, So yeah, you know, at the time, you know, I had like already like built the name for myself with Tri-City, battle rapping, you know, talent show, College Park talent shows, College Park Auditorium had talent shows, then East Point Run the Street Gym had talent shows, and I was doing mixtapes with DJ Fonzo. So I already made a name for myself, you know, around the city and local hood. So I just wanted something bigger and better, man. You know, so what I did was, I stepped to Charles Jr. and was like, man, look at man, why don't you? Now, first I stepped to Poojay. Poojay was Charles Jr.'s cousin, but he used to work for Charles Jr. But since I used to have a regular dialogue with, you know, I used to kick it with Poojay regular, I said, Poojay, man, why don't you go ask Charles Jr. to invest in me, man? Start a record company. Like Def Jam. And sign me. Drop me. I'm going to blow up.
He's
like, man, why don't you go holler? And it was in 87. So he's like, why don't you just holler?
Okay.
I'm like, I don't know, man. So I walked down there, and I seen Charles coming out. You know, Charles, he was just gold, dressed up. I say, Charles, look at man. I'm going to start a record label, man. I was like, no, I'm hot, man. I'm going to mix tapes, man. Now, first I walked up to him. I said, man, look, boy, I can rap, man. I got these mixtapes going up in the city, man. He stopped me. He said, man, I know I'm listening to one right now in the car. You know, I was like, okay, cool. So that kind of, you know, that kind of made me a little bit, you know, more amped to tell him. So I said, man, well, why don't you just start a record label, man? And why don't you start a record label? Sign me. I'm telling you, man, I know I can come up, but I can tell you I dropped this shit. I'm going to make a hit off top, man. I'm telling you, man. So I was passionate about it, and I believed in it. So he said, I'm going to think about it. So I don't think that, you know, I'm like, damn, I didn't think that was about it. Next day, He came and said, man, you ready? I said, ready for what? He said, shit, I'm going to put this money behind you. What you going to do? I like, damn, you know what I'm saying? So I realized I was ready, but I wasn't ready. You know? So, but I knew others that knew things, just like I said, Benjamin Middlebrook. I knew he knew the business. I didn't know no studios. You know, at that time, you know, that's when you had to have a lot of money to get in the rap industry. Because beat machines were $1,000 a battle, $2,000-$3,000 for a beat machine, $100 an hour for studio time, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't like it is now. Mm. Computers, Fruity Loops, Pro Tools, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, you had to have some amount of money. So Ben Turner's on the Nitschke Lake, 2560 Nitschke Lake, Eddie Irons. He was in the group Brick.
So we went in there,
you know. So I was like, damn, what is the first thing I'm going to make? I said, what am I going to rap about? I said, well, damn. I just rap about where I'm living, my life, hood, selling drugs. But I said, no. I said, well, I can stop selling drugs, so I ain't worried about knocking me up. But I like, no, they selling drugs. I said, the niggas behind me selling drugs. So I said, well, I can't rap about that. So then I would be telling on them. I said, well, I can't do that. So I just was like, I got to rely on my skills, just the cat that I am, the guy that I am, you know what I'm saying? So went in there, you know what I'm saying, wrote that Who Rock, you know, which was a concert song. So I laid down Who Rock, and then you lay down a single, flip side, back side. You go in there, single drop. So right away, we got to know if you that guy or not. You put it like this. Wasn't too many people finna invest no whole album in you unless you done show you that dude. So he did, it was like,
right.
So you drop a single, you know. That's why Raheem was dropping a single. You know, you hot dropping singles, goals, you know what I'm saying? But I went and dropped a single. Who Rock, which was a part of song, Hood song. Then on the flip side, I had Cut It Up. Cut It Up was a song that I studied dictionary. I used to study dictionary. I was really like, really on point with the lyrics. I didn't take lyrics until this day. Writing, you know, I always been a writer, songwriter, script writer. I'm a writer, even now and then.
Okay.
So I just wanted to show on the flip side of Cut It Up. Well, Cut It Up, I wanted to show to the New York cat that I can do what they doing. Then I made Who Rock and show that y'all can't do what I do. You know what I'm saying? So the whole album, because at that time they were saying New York people couldn't, a lot of people couldn't rap because, you know, the South couldn't rap, Atlanta couldn't rap. So that's why my whole album, The Real Stuff, which I'm going to get it to you, was just be just a phenomenal display of styles. Like, I'm going to show these boys I can do whatever.
Yes, sir.
Jam.
That's right. That's right.
Jam it.
Yeah, let's check them out.
Let it. Rip. The concept of this rhyme are definitely inclined. You'll be total freak out when you hear the design. The content of this event is exuberant. So boogie on down as I release elements. Let it rip. Consternation is the thing that I bring. We got the Rollins and the 12 to make good ills. Ruin the devastator, zone of fader, adversary, terminator. This says are so nimble, no other can resemble. The lyrics in the script is by assembled. The supreme team, I'm hotter than steam. Through cruising, penetrating, while the sound is circulating. From head to toe, I'm simply stimulating. It's fact, not fiction. And as an addition, we'll see. The cut techniques and parallel reciprocal projection regulated. All relentless adversaries will be eliminated by Einstein, Beethoven of the rhyme. The projection and the structure, and you will find that it's strictly integrated. I'm not intimidated. I just hope and I pray that you won't duplicate it. Let it real.
Let it real. So you say you was coming at them with the wordplay, with the different styles. You wasn't coming with that regular Atlanta sound. You was coming with that up north real hip hop, trying to battle rap type verses with that thing.
I will say I was bred on hip hop, you know, hip hop, New York hip hop. What you know, which I love, because it was like you had to be like, you had to know your thing. You know, you had to know your stuff. You know what I'm saying? One of them old companies, I'll say this. You know what I'm saying? You had to know your stuff. But then me, I always just took pride, man, you know, my lyrics, you know, my writing, you know what I'm saying, and things like that nature. So, like I said, I just wanted to show that, you know, I can do what y'all do, but y'all can't do what I do, you know?
Yes,
you know?
Sir.
Right. Well, you're a student of the game, man. Student of the game, man, you know?
Yeah.
Hey, nigga, I want to say a shout out, man. This shirt I got on, I don't know if you see it. Hold on, let me get it right. Street Zone.
Street Zone. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Street Zone DVD. Hold on, let me get it right.
Okay.
The reason I want to do that, because I got to shout out the Rock Man Street Zone DVD. Because I got to tell you this story about him. He lived in Martel home. You know, back in those days, the school was right across the street from the project. You walked out the project, it was Quilliam Elementary right across from the project. That's with me, Coco, Rockmon, Street Zone DVD. But anyway, and see, this is the thing about it. Now, remember I was telling y'all, I was living in splendor and luxury when I was at Bolden Park Drive? And when I moved to my home, it was straight poverty, which I didn't care. And my mom, my friends, and the music. It didn't matter. But anyway,
right.
One day, I know I was like in the fourth grade. Coming from school and walking up it. And we had got put out. I'm talking about, like, put out, you know, like, furniture on the side of the street. I'm talking about walking with Quilliam, and then, you know, with all the kids, we walking, and all y'all furniture on the side of the street. And so I will say, Rockmon, his dad and them, you know, no hesitation, just like, you know, took us in, you know, furniture on the street, got situated straight, you know, got everything straight, but I'm saying, helped us get right. So, you know what I'm saying? That was, it's kind of funny, because that was his daddy. And, so this him, Street Zone's DVD.
Street Zone DVD.
Shout out Street Zone DVD, man.
So a lot of my friends, man, you know, they done see me like, you know, the greatest. They done see me, you know, at my most humblest. You know, I would never say low, because I've never seen myself lower than that. But I say the most humblest, you know, whatever. But, you know, but even the way, man, you know, I would have my head high, you know. Just like little baby say, man, I've been too solid. Some got to give, you know what I'm saying?
Something got to give, man. Hey. Yes, sir. Hey. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right. Y'all okay. Youngsters, man. You know, really, you know what? It seems to be like an issue. Like, I know a lot of older rappers, younger rappers, they seem to have, you know, like a little friction. But you know, the way I see, but see, I guess for me, because I'm trying to come up, I'm in the street with younger rappers every day, like in my city. So we pretty much the same, except for my older, but we vibe like age ain't no, like we, you know what I'm saying? Age don't even come into question.
Mm-hmm. And that's so how it should be.
Yeah. And I like to say, tip my hat to all the artists after myself, even on up to this day from Atlanta, that kept Atlanta going. Because no doubt, me personally, I'm not surprised Atlanta dominating in the industry, entertainment, sports, none of that. Because like I say, I always thought Martel home, I was the realest. I was the baddest. I was the greatest. So basically, everybody in Atlanta, we all thought the same.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's right. That's right.
You know what I'm
That's
saying?
Right. That's right. Martel Holmes, man.
You know what I'm saying? So,
yes,
you, know, so you know, that's... So I'm not surprised, man. You know, we got the culture. I'm not a bit of surprised. I'm going to be honest with you now. You know? And that ain't no
well,
lie.
You know what? That's why we got this show, though, man. Because, you know, like I say, without us, it really ain't no them. You know what I mean? We want to set the cities on fire, man. You know, all the ones like you that started out, man, and built that foundation and stuff for, man. So we more definitely, man, want to get you on the show, man, and, you know, give you your roses, man, where you spend them things while you're still here, man, and everything. And, yeah, you know, just letting everybody know, man, where this thing came from, man, to give everybody their props, man, they recognition that they deserve, man, because y'all, you know, most definitely, man, set the blaze, the trail blazer, man, and stuff like that in this game. So I appreciate you, man.
Yes, so definitely. Shout out to you, man. Like you say, we want to give you roses while you're here. We want to let everybody know who the original D-Rock is, right? We want to let them know it's a reason why D-Rock spell his name D-R-O-C, because it was already a D-Rock, R-O-C-K. So it's a reason why. So we wanted this being Atlanta rap history. We got to bring you the history. We got to let you know the beginning.
Yeah.
Where it started at.
That's
where
right.
It first came from. And like you said, this was 1987. So y'all think back on that. 1987. The hottest song in the A was D-Rock, Hoorah, Hoorah. Yeah.
Skyline in the back. Y'all remember that label, man, when we first decided to choose that label.
But
let me say this. When I got finished with that song, Mixed and Master, came out initially late. I never get it. It was the summer, August of 87. So birthday was just past June. I just turned 18. So they have a Jack the Rapper convention, right? Jack the Rapper convention.
Jack the Rapper. They
So they had this at the, I think it was in College Park on Best Road or something. So me and my homie, we ride to the place because we tried to catch up with Luke, trying to keep up with somebody. So soon as we go there, we see Luke, you know, the camera's in his face. But Luke had just went gold on his first CD. You know, independent, you know, he's the first cat out of the South. In my opinion, it's my opinion now, Luke Skywalker is the original, or was the first original, whatever you want to call it, king of the South. Mm-hmm. You know, because he's the first guy that went gold independent, you know, back then, you know what I'm saying? Don't get me wrong, Master P showed you how to do a whole industry. Now, what he did was something totally different.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just saying, Luke Luke was that guy. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't a party without a Two Live Crew party. Y'all know that for yourself.
That's right. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah.
But check it out. So I seen Luke. I'm talking about bold enough. Cat, 18, walk up to, hey, man, look at him, man. This is the hottest single, boy. Look at him. You need to put this out. All the cameras around him. They looking at me. He like, man, look, give me a minute. Let me get back on this too. I was like, man, you need to listen to him now. He like, well, go get a tape play or something. So we went to scrambling. So he said, go get back with me. We went to scrambling. Then when I came back, I ran up on Mr. Mix, Dave Hobbs. So I said, man, we trying to catch up with Luke. He's like, man, let me hear what you got. I played that Who Rock. But look up. He said, but look up. Luke ain't signing. Nobody else. You know what I'm saying? So I guess, you know, no cap. You know, I guess, you know, well, I mean, lack of better word, I ain't gonna say, well, hey, but, you know, for lack of better, we're not gonna use that word. But I'm gonna say, for like, he was concerned that is, he concerned that this was gonna take over everything, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, I guess, you know, whatever you wanna call it. But anyway, so, but at the same time, the whole while, he stood there for like 2-3 hours talking to us. You know what I'm saying? Right. I'm like, man, damn, I didn't see Luke. Then here come a cat dancing down the hallway. Who rocked this mother? Boom, boom, boom. I'm like, he got on two big ass silver ropes. I'm talking about like a Porsche symbol and a Mercedes symbol. He's like, oh man, that's you. I'm like, yeah. He said, I told him that was me. He introduced himself as Stanley Kirk Burrell. You know, that's MC Hammer. So he said he had busted productions, busted records, and things like that. So he said, I like that. Cool. We exchanged numbers and shit. But then I was so arrogant, you know, You know, I wanted to hook up with Luke. I was so arrogant, man, who is you? So, you know, I will say, it's kind of funny, because later on that same year, he ended up blowing through the roof. And for the next four Jack the Rapper conventions, see, that's all you talk about with Hammer.
Yeah.
But, you know, we were like, who is this cat dance, whatever. But anyway, when we left, Benjamin Middlebrooks was like, man, y'all can start your own record label. Damn these guys and him. So we went out and started on record label, man. You know, start on record label. You know, that's when you had the station where 104.7 was the rap station in Atlanta at the time. You remember that?
104.7.
Okay. When they first came.
I think I remember a guy named Butch Winston. And, but you know, I had many opportunities, man, to go to the next level, man. But I guess at the time, I was loyal to the guys that brought me in, you know, because, I mean, I had guys say, boy, look at these. Signed a contract, boy, I'm going to take you here, take you there. Atlantic Records, you know, came to 300,000, you know. Charles Jr. said Def Jam Records was interested. But, you know, I was in the street, you know. I was still in the street doing my thing and shit getting hot. Oh, yeah. Let me say this right here, though. I skipped over a part. But I'm going to say, when I first came out of the studio with the Who Rock song, and remember Ben's turn us on in Nisky Lake, said, look, turn y'all on, I ain't got nothing else to do with it. So I came out of the studio. I said, Ben, we went, me and Charles Jr. went to Ben, don't knock on the door, say, man, look, I want you to be our manager. He said, man, I ain't been no manager, I ain't getting into that, none of that. I said, man, just be our manager. Me, I like to make things happen. I said, I'll tell you what, just listen to it then. See what you think about it. I played it. He said, that's you? Man, I'm your manager. Nigga, you gonna be rich.
I'm your manager.
Hey, look, you know what I'm saying? He's like, I'm your manager, but you're gonna be rich. So I thought he was gas members at the first. I like, he said, boy, I'm telling you, deep boy, look at him. So that's why I gotta give Ben, man. He's the first one that really just opened my eyes and that shit. Boy, look here. When that thing hit, impact. So, you know, we did our start our own record label, promoted ourselves. I remember it was the winter of 87. We went on the road. You know, it was like we started with the country town. Like I say, we hired Raheem to be my opener. Compton, Carrollton, Georgia, you know, Megan. You know, what else? I mean, a lot of the time, you know,
what I'm a George, everything.
A lot of them, you know.
The Chitty Circuit.
Well, I love that. I love that. But the thing about it is, when we put it in the work, and then, like, we hit the old town first, and then made the way back to Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
And then we made the way back to Atlanta, you know, it's always big. But I remember one of my best-selling stores was in the, what was it, Peppermint in the West End Mall?
Yeah, Peppermint in the West End Mall, right in the front of the mall.
Yeah. Well, look at that. That slide of them singles, boy, couldn't stay in there. You know, so went to a lot of places, man. You know, and so that's what that's what I love, the independent route. You know, a lot of people love the.
Right.
You know what I'm saying, I love the build.
Yes, sir.
So let me ask you this: what's some other cities and states you went to, man, to do shows and stuff, man, while you was out there?
Well, I remember going to New York. You know. Because we went to New York one time, they had a meeting with, Bob Suede or somebody, you know, we was trying to get on a promotional tour, Run DMC and all that, you know, been to the Red Parrot, that's way back in the days of New York City. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we went to, Shreveport, you know, the Carolinas, we had widespread distribution throughout Chicago. You know, of course, Florida and Bama, towns like that, you know. So basically, we just blanket the whole Southeast region. But at the same time, I was being distributed by world premier, Brian Lasseter.
World premier.
I love to see what he's doing right today, Brian Lasseter. So if y'all ever run across that cat, tell him D-Rock won't holler at him, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. But listen, before we let you go, man, like I always say, but it's the fastest hour of the week. But before we let you go, I need to get, at least tell me one good story about the legendary Charles Disco.
I remember I was in that one night, man, and you know, I'm gold and draped up, you know, D-Rock rocking the name, but that boy Cowfetch won Mr. Gold that night. You know what I'm saying?
Cowfetch. You
know, Cowfetch won Mr. Gold that night, man, you know. So, you know. But yeah, Charles Disco, that was the place, man, where the legends come out, the big ballers. You know, that was like Vegas. You know, Charles Disco was like Vegas.
Yeah. You know? And this long before the word balling even came out. Now, we talking about the 80s. Now, this before the word balling came out. But listen what he said. They was having a Mr. Gold contest. They having a contest. You walk in the club and see who got the most gold on to win the contest. This is what they was doing. This how much money was in the city back in the early 80s, the way they having a Mr. Gold contest at the world famous Charles Disco, man.
Yeah, we always turned up, man. It ain't no coincidence that it's like this today, man. We always been like a, man, if you even look back, man, we always been like a place for black thinkers, movers and shakers and grinders, man. You know, we hustle, man, you know what I'm saying? You know?
And then that's we got right. A strong home money makers and the booty shaker, baby.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We got a strong musical legacy. Mm-hmm. And it was one time Auburn Avenue had more black millionaires on that stretch than anywhere in the United States.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Black Wall Street, man.
The Black Wall Street, man. The history, man. Know your history. Yep. Know your history, man. But like we say always about this time, man, it's the fastest hour of the week, man. We want to thank our guest, man, the original D-Rock. Like I said, I got to admit when I was wrong, I had the wrong D-Rock picture up there. But now, for now on, we got the right D-Rock picture up there. Because when Raheem said, who rock, that's when D-Rock came through.
D-Rock.
And Sammy Sound the Hit, man, was all brand new, man. And we got the original D-Rock with us tonight, man. We thank you. We salute you. Man, let them know where they can find you at.
Oh, man. Right now, man, I started my new company, Martel Money Music. And it's a media company. And I'm going to come out a new podcast, EP at Night. It's a official podcast in East Point, Georgia. And, you know, we're in the city, finna drop music. We about to come out and Oak Hill, yeah, listen to my son, Prue Getty, ready. So we about to do this thing, man. East Point, now salute all the rappers, young and old. Let's get this money, man.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Yes, sir. Magic Mar, let them know where they can find you at.
Oh, man, they know they can find me on IG, man, at Magic Mar. That's Magic with a K-100.
Yeah, my yes, sir. You can find me on IG, D-Rock Get It, or you can find me on IG, Martel Money Music. Facebook, D-Rock Get It. Twitter, D-Rock Get It, Martel Money Music. You know what I'm saying? The same. I'm the same on all platforms, man. I don't change, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Like you say, Magic Mark, man, y'all can catch him on IG, man. That Magic with a what? K.
With a K.
100.
100.
Yes, sir, man. Hey, man. Right. Make sure y'all follow us on IG at Atlanta Rap History. Man, make sure you leave a comment. Make sure you like, share this thing, man. And make sure you hit that notification button so you ain't got to call me talking about what time y'all coming on. Hit the notification button, man. Like we always say, man, peace up, A-Town down.